Welcome back to Milan Recording Studios. My name is James Pavel Chakras, and in today's video, like always as of lately, I'm going to be doing a comparison between two digital pianos. However, this video is going to be a bit of a different twist. A lot of the times when I review two digital pianos, I'll usually compare two that are in the same price class. But in this case, I'm not doing that, and instead I'm reviewing two different digital pianos that are much differently priced. But instead, the thing they have in common is that they're both made by Yamaha. So on top, we have the Yamaha P125, and on the bottom we have the Yamaha P515. The P125 is a more affordable, more of an entry-level type instrument that's geared towards beginner and intermediate piano students, whereas the P515 is a bit more of a professional, higher quality instrument and is also more expensive, and it's geared towards like intermediate to advanced intermediate piano students, as well as people who might want to perform live. So we're going to be taking a look at both of these today and checking out all of the similarities and differences. I'm actually going to be running through like all the different sounds of both of these because they don't have a massive amount of sounds, which is actually kind of nice because I can show you every single one for both of these instruments. And I'll also tell you about some of the other similarities and differences between the two. But first of all, I think the first thing I'm going to do is just start and play some piano music on the two of these. Let's try out the first Bach fugue from the Well-Tempered Clavier on the P515 and the P125. I think what I'll do is I'll play the full thing on the 515 and the full thing on the 125, just to make it easy. I can't really switch very easily with that piece. But later on, I'll go back and forth in the same song or in the same piece, whatever I'm playing at the time, and then you'll get a really true side-by-side comparison of the two. Thank you. That's one of my favorite pieces to play on both acoustic pianos and digital pianos. It's challenging both for myself and the instrument I'm playing it on. Sometimes it gets the better of me, sometimes it gets the better of the instrument, and in this case, both of these digital pianos handled it perfectly fine. I didn't really have any issues regarding the action and the playability of the instrument with either piece. I was able to bring the melodies out in the piece as they basically should be played, and I didn't really have any trouble. So that's the really nice thing about the P125 as well. Obviously, the action does feel different, and I'll talk more about that later. It still does have a lot of the dynamic control and playability that you'd expect in a higher quality and higher priced instrument, even though it's actually pretty affordable for the general population. Let's play a little bit more piano music here. I'm going to play my treble test piece and my bass test piece on the 515 and the 125, and this time I'll go back and forth in the same piece so you can really get a side-by-side comparison of the two pianos. So there we go, that was the default piano patch of the 515 and the 125 playing my treble test piece and my bass test piece. I kind of merged the two together, which I've never done before, really. Let me know what you think of that. Usually I keep them as two separate pieces, but I thought I'd try to merge them together. So as you can hear, there are some differences between the sound of the default piano patch, the CFX Grand on the P515, and the default piano patch of the P125, which I believe was recorded of a Yamaha CF3S. At least that's what somebody online told me. I believe that is correct. So part of the difference between the sounds that we have here is because they were sampled from a different type of Yamaha piano. And while a sampled piano does not sound exactly like its true original acoustic counterpart, I've made several videos regarding that, there will be differences in tone when you sample one piano and then sample another piano. And also, I believe the 125 uses different technology in it to reproduce the sampled sound, so that also is part of the difference. One thing with the P125 is, like, if you play a note very quietly and you slowly ramp up the sound, it's actually the same tone for a little bit of the dynamic spread, if you know what I mean, the dynamic range, and the P515 doesn't seem to do that as much or at all from what I can tell. So there are some different technologies and stuff going on inside of these two instruments. And of course, the P515 is sampling CFX, and the 125 is a CF3S, which I believe was an older model of Concert Grand. The P515, I think, sounds better for the default CFX Grand, but the one that I think sounds really amazing on the 515 for certain types of music is the Bösendorfer sample. There's also a Bösendorfer piano sample on the 515, which the 125 does not have, and this alone, I think, makes the 125 just so much more amazing over the 125. Like, obviously it's gonna be better, it's a more expensive instrument, but just this sample alone sounds absolutely beautiful here. Let me demonstrate a few different pieces, and I'll also play them on the 125. I'll use the same default patch, just to show you guys the differences between the default patch up here and the Bösendorfer sample down here. Some of you may have recognized that piece of music, and as you can tell, it fits absolutely beautifully on the Bösendorfer sample. Now, the nice thing I want to point out here is that while the Bösendorfer sample is obviously a lot nicer for that type of music than the default sample of the P125, the P125 is still capable of the same dynamic ranges of the P515. I do have to kind of approach each instrument differently, because the 125 has a much different feeling action than the 515, but you can still get the same super, super quiet dynamics and still get the treble to sing out a little bit louder, even on the P125. So that's really great. Even though the action isn't as nice as on the 515, you're still able to do just about everything with it that the 515 can do, which is really, really awesome. You're not going to be hindered all that much by buying the lesser expensive instrument. As I mentioned, there are a few different piano patches on here. In another video I did, I breezed over them and people said that they did want to hear all of the different acoustic piano variants. So now I think I'll play just a little bit of various things here on all the different piano samples of both the 515 and the 125. I'll start off with the 125 and just play a few chords of each piano sample. You'll see me change the sounds here. And then I'll also do the same for the 515. So here we go. Thank you. So those are all of the piano sounds of the 515 and the 125. A lot of the ones in the 515 are simply the CFX sample, just EQ'd a little bit differently to make it a little more mellow or a little bit bright, but it is still nice to have a different variance of piano tones in there. So those are all the tones of the 515. I believe there's about 8 of them on the 515, and there's only 4 of the 125. Of course, with the more expensive instrument, you get more sounds. Now, I've mentioned the action a couple of times in this video, so I think now it's about time that I discuss that a little bit. The action of the 125, especially for the price class of the instrument that it is actually very nice. It's one of the best feeling actions in its price class, rivaled, in my opinion, only by the Kawai ES-110, although many people would argue that the Roland FP30 has a bit of a more realistic feeling action, which in some aspects it does. The 125 has a bit more fluidity to it, if you will. It's a bit more nimble, and you can do faster repetitions and stuff with the 125 action, the GHS action, than you can with Roland's PHA4 action. The 515 action, though, is a whole different beast compared to the 125. It's so much better. It's even more nimble, interestingly. I find that it repeats a little bit faster and a little bit quicker and more crisp than the action of the 125. Although, as I mentioned, playing with the 125, you don't really get hindered all that much. You can still play all the same dynamic range and stuff, but doing trills and fast repetitions is easier on the 515, even though the action definitely does feel a little bit heavier. It has a very crisp feeling to it, a very nice feeling action. I really, really like it. So basically the 515, of course, has the better action, but honestly the 125 is still pretty good, especially for the price class. Something else that's definitely upgraded about the P515 is the fact that the speakers are much larger. You can see here that the speaker grills are very big. And are there holes underneath? No, there are no speakers underneath like on the 125. The 125 has little speakers up top and then bigger speakers down on the bottom. The 515 only has big speakers, but they're up on top here. So the 515 definitely sounds a lot better than the 125, but honestly, the speakers of the 125, once again, do get the job done, especially for practicing at home. Another great thing about both of these instruments is that they have dedicated line out ports in the back. So the thing about line output jacks, is that technically the big quarter inch headphone jacks that you'll find up here can technically be used for the same thing. You can record through a headphone jack, you can output a signal to an amp through the headphone jack, but the signal is definitely not as high quality as if you did it through the line output jacks in the back of the instrument. Both the 125 and the 515 have dedicated output jacks, meaning that both of them, even the 125 for its relatively affordable price, can theoretically be used on location. Which one would I recommend better for location? Well, I think part of that would kind of depend up to you, because the 125 is a lot lighter than the 515, and that's a big factor a lot of people discuss about whether a piano is good for them for gigging. The 515 has a higher build quality, of course, than the 125. It has this big metal front plate up here, it's got thicker quality plastic on top, and the bottom is like the solid sheet of very thick, durable plastic. So, and also it has these wooden keys, which aren't making the P515 any lighter either. So the 515 is heavier, but also a bit more sturdy and does have a few better sounds in it. The 125 is lighter. If you dropped it, it may have some issues. The plastic on here isn't as high quality as the 515's plastic, but honestly, the 125 still would be a very viable option for gigging. You got the line outputs, you got some decent sounds in here, you got a good Rode sound, we'll talk about that. You got some good piano sounds, even some good organ sounds, and some other things as well, like a walking bass line and all sorts of stuff. So both of these are viable for gigging. Which one would be better for you, I think, is literally up to you, but both of them do work perfectly fine for gigging. I mentioned the Rode sound, so let's move on to the electric piano category of both of these instruments, the 515 and the 125. I'm going to play this weird little Rode test piece I've kind of come up with in the last few weeks. I've been playing it off and on throughout my videos whenever I'm playing a digital piano with a Rode sound. Let's play that on the 515 and the 125 and see how they compare. Thank you. was using the wrong pedal there on the 125, which is why the last note came out staccato. But as you can hear, both of the electric piano sounds here, the Rhodes sound, the first one in the category, is actually pretty decent sounding for both of them. I think I like the one on the 515 a bit more, but the 125's Rhodes sound is actually pretty decent as well. It has a bit of a more bell-like singing quality to it, whereas the 515 is a little bit more percussive and kind of punchy sounding, so it depends on what type of music you might want to do, but I do like the Rhodes sound of both of these digital pianos. Now, the electric piano category is probably one of the most interesting categories of these instruments because of the similarities and differences, and probably the most interesting difference between these two is the DXE piano sound. So the Yamaha DX7 was a very popular like FM synthesis instrument used during the 70s and 80s, and basically every piece of music, at least it seems to me, looking back on that time, virtually every pop ballad and pop song of the time was written or included a Yamaha DX7. So it's a very popular sound even to this day, so many people look for one in a digital piano. What's interesting, though, to me is the difference between them. Some of these instruments do share a couple of sounds. One of the sounds they do not share is the DX sound. Let me know which one of these you like more. In my opinion, I actually like the one of the P125 more, oddly enough. I think it reminds me more of those 70s songs that I've heard over the years, and it just sounds a lot like the Yamaha DX. This one down here, I don't actually like the DX sound as much as on the 125. The next sound we have here is called Vintage EP, and I believe it's the same one up here on the 125, and it is basically an emulation of a Wurlitzer 200. Let's have a listen to that. They're basically the same exact sound between the two. I think the one up on the P125 has a bit of tremolo in it. This one also has a tremolo version of the same sound, so that's pretty cool. They're both pretty nice, but I think for that particular piece, the action of the 515 works a little bit better. It's a little bit more springy than that of the 125 as well, so it makes it really, really easy to play these nice, crisp staccato notes and just make them be very, very brisk and very clean, which also kind of lends to its clean-esque quality that I mentioned earlier, its crispness. We also have a soft electric piano, which is basically a softer, more mellow Fender Rhodes with a very prominent auto pan. Check this out. That's a new classical piece I'm working on, and I definitely was playing it faster than I should have there, but it sounds really cool on the soft electric piano, very prominent auto pan, and it has a very nice tone. Up next on the 515, there is a phaser EP, which is kind of like the soft EP, but with a phaser instead of a auto pan. One of the final sounds here for the electric piano category of the P515 is a bright version of the DX, and then after that is a tremolo version of the Whirly we heard earlier. Let's check that out. For the P515, that is the final sound of the electric piano category, but there is one more for the P125 that we didn't look at, and that is a synth type of pad. I'll just play a quick chord on it so you get an idea of what the sound is. The next category we have here for the sounds is the organ for both of these. And so some of these share some of the organ sounds, and some of the organ sounds are different for both of them. For the P125, the first organ sound is unique to the P125. I don't think you'll find it on the 515. Here's how that sounds. On the 515, the organ sound is this. The next one for the 515 is called Jazz Organ Fast. Up next is called Rock Organ. It's the same exact rock organ as the second organ for the P125. Have a listen to that. Up next for the P515 is a jazz organ once again. And up next for both of them are organ principles. So basically, this is the sound of a church organ. Up next is organ tutti, which is another version of the church organ. It's basically like with all of the stops pulled out. They're both the exact same sound, and they're both magnificent on both of these two instruments. Up next, we have the clavinet and vibraphone section, which are exactly identical on both the P125 and the 515. The first two sounds are a harpsichord. The first one is just using the 8-foot stop, and the second one uses the 8-foot and the 4-foot stop, so it adds an octaved sound to the harpsichord. And it's the exact same for the 125. You can have the 8-foot stop and also the 8-foot and the 4-foot. The next variation for both of these is the electric clavichord, better known as the Hohner clavinet. Final sound in this category, and again, it's the same for both, is a very nice vibraphone sound. The next category here is strings, and these do share a few of the string pads, although the P125 has less of them than the 515. The first one, if I remember right, is a fast type of strings that you can play faster music, and the second one is a slower strings pad that you can play slower music with. The string pads die away very quickly when you have the pedal held down, so the fade there is a little bit goofy, but you definitely get the idea that those are the two different types of string pads. Up next for the P515, we have a choir, and I think we also have the same choir on the 125. The 515 also has a slow choir as well that the 125 does not have. The 125 up next is a pad, and the 515 has three different pads. The first one being the dark pad, second one being the light pad, and the third one being the bell pad. My favorite of the three is the dark pad. It works really well with the piano. I'll do that here in a second. But let me just show you guys the pads of both of these, and then I'll layer the dark pad with the piano and play a bit of that. I pushed a couple of wrong buttons there when I set up the split thing, so it took me a little while longer than I would have liked, but actually setting up the split is very easy when you don't push the piano room button by accident. You push the dual slash split button once to set up the dual mode, which is going to be layering the sound. The sound on top is going to be the one that you already had selected, the one that was playing previously. That sound is going to be louder than the one that's on the bottom of the screen there, so you can set those two up and combine any two sounds of the instrument you want. The next setup, if you push the button again, is going to... Actually, it left it for some reason. Next up is going to be the split mode, which is literally going to split it into two different sounds. Again, you can customize which sounds there are. If you hit that button a third time, it's actually going to give you a split and layer functionality. So the section, it splits the keyboard in half, so on one side, and you can customize the split point, on one side you're going to have one sound, and on the other side you're actually going to have the layered sound of any two instruments that you choose. So that's pretty cool as well. One thing I do like about the P515 and the 125 is that the user interface is very, very simple. On many instruments of this price point, and at least several of them that I can think of, sometimes to change the sounds, you have to hold down a button and push keys to change the different sounds. Yamaha opted to not do that, which is really fantastic. Instead, as you've seen multiple times, you just push the same button over and over again to toggle through the sounds. I like that a lot more. The P125 does have features hidden in the keys, like adjusting the brightness, turning on and off the speakers, but those aren't features you're going to use on a daily basis, so I really don't mind that as much as literally hiding the sounds in the keys and having to remember which keys change which sounds. The P515 has no features hidden in the keys, at least not that I know of. Everything is here in this menu, which is very easy to operate. You hit the function button to enter the menu, then you can go in there using these arrow keys and change all sorts of different things. One really cool thing about the 515 that I like is the fact that you can actually go in here and change the master tuning of the instrument to basically whatever you want, and there's also even different temperaments that you can choose. So if I increase the master tuning here to, say, 459.4, play a chord and then reset it, you'll definitely hear a pitch change. You can do that with any instrument across the across the keyboard. Once you set the master tuning, all the instruments on the keyboard are going to change their pitch, not just the dark pad. So that's a really cool feature. And then also you can even go in there and change the temperament. Now, while this is a really awesome feature, and also it has a built-in metronome, both of these do in fact, and while that's really awesome, not everybody practices on a digital piano. So as a result, for the fun thing I figured I would do in this video is I thought I would give away this Korg metronome. This is actually a combo of a metronome and a tuner, which is really, really, really fantastic. Now, I do have to admit I don't have any experience with this exact device, but I have used Korg tuners and Korg, actually not Korg metronomes, but definitely Korg tuners in the past. I think I've had two of them, and they've both been very, very nice. I use a Korg tuner all the time to tune my harpsichord whenever I feel like recording that. It's the Korg tuner that I have that I use is more of a guitar-based tuner, so it picks up the harpsichord better than a piano tuner does, but this is a multi-instrument tuner. So it wouldn't really be the best for tuning your whole piano because it's not going to have a stretch pitch, so the bass notes aren't going to be stretched a little bit farther to farther down, and the treble keys aren't going to be stretched a little farther apart, but this could be used in a couple of different ways for those of you who own a piano. You could simply just go in there and tweak a few notes that the unisons go out on, which is very, very easy. All you need is a tuning hammer and a mute, so you can just simply go in there and mute the strings that are out of unison and use this to bring that unison note back into pitch with itself. You could also use it to give your piano a basic approximate tuning throughout every register of the instrument that this thing can recognize, which I think will be the majority of it, and you can do that right before your piano tuner comes if your piano was way out of tune before that, so that then your piano tuner won't have to do like chip tunings and come back over and over again, or do a pitch raise, which is raising the pitch of the piano higher than it should be, so as it naturally falls out of tune, it comes back down into the normal pitch. Basically, perhaps tuning your piano a little bit beforehand with this, before your tuner comes out, might help alleviate some of those extra costs. Also, it's a metronome, which is absolutely wonderful too. So I'll be giving this away to one of my lucky subscribers in the comments of this video. The only requirement is that you do have to be subscribed, and I can actually see this on my YouTube channel, so if you're not subscribed, you won't be eligible. So if you want to possibly enter to win this, definitely make sure you are subscribed to the channel. Otherwise, just go ahead and leave a nice comment about me or the videos or what you want to do with this tuner, and then if you win, I will give you my contact info and you can send me your info so I can send this to you. I really hope that you guys do enjoy that. And now let's get on with the video. So let's continue on with the video and review it now, and let's move on to the final category of these sounds, which is the bass and others category for the 515. I believe the basses are about the same for both of these instruments, and the way they work up here is you push the plus bass button and it will add a bass sound here. If you hold it and you tap a key, it will set a split point there. So above it we have strings, and below that we should have bass. So that's basically how that there works, and let's have a listen to the bass sounds now. That last bass sound there is definitely different on the 125 than on the 515. It's more of a plucked bass on the, or a slap bass on the 515, and more of a plucked muted bass on the 125. The P515 has two unique sounds in the others category, is the nylon guitar and the steel guitar. Let's have a quick listen to those. Thank you. And those are all of the sounds of the P515 and the P125. So that's every single piano sound, every electric piano, organ, and everything for both of these instruments. So I definitely hope that you guys enjoyed that in-depth look at all of the different sounds. Now, needless to say, I do like both of these digital pianos, and obviously the P515 is better. It's got better speakers, it has more sounds, it has better sounds, the action is better, basically everything about it is better. But that's not really to say that the 125 is bad. It's a much more affordable instrument, and in its price class, it's definitely one of the best instruments. But I've had a lot of requests for not only for Yamaha, but also for Kawai and other brands to take a look at their differently priced keyboards. I received a suggestion a couple days ago to review the ES110, the ES8, and the MP11, because they're like double the price each time, and I will be doing that as soon as my ES8 and MP11 SE come in, whenever that happens. But for now, I do have the 125 and the 515 here, so I figured I would do a video comparing those two as well. So I really hope that you guys have enjoyed this video. Needless to say, both of these are really fantastic and I absolutely love them. The P515 is better though, but if you can only afford the 125, you really can't go wrong with it. It's still a very solid instrument for an entry level or intermediate piano student. 515 though is wonderful and I love it a lot. Especially that Busendorfer piano sample, that's just my favorite of this whole instrument. That alone is almost worth the price of the P515, to be honest with you. But I really hope that you guys have enjoyed this video of these two instruments. If you liked it, you might want to think about subscribing, or at the very least, going and checking out my channel, because I have done lots of cool videos of other digital pianos, comparing the P125 against the instruments that it is comparable with as far as the price class. So I've done videos comparing it against the ES110 and the Roland FP30 and a couple of others as well, I think. So I've had videos of that. I also have videos of acoustic pianos, if that's more your type of thing. And I've also even done videos of organs and other keyboards and keyboard instruments, and even sometimes other stuff too. So if any of that sounds cool, you might want to think about subscribing. And don't forget, you do have to be subscribed if you want to win that Korg metronome. Just let me know that you are interested in it in your comment, and you will be eligible for the giveaway if you are subscribed as well. So hopefully you guys have enjoyed all that. Hopefully you guys go check out my channel. If you want to subscribe, thank you very much, and I'll see you in the next video. Goodbye.